People without faith constitute a small minority, but they remain off the spectrum because they're not thought of as a minority. So their viewpoints, their political agendas, their discomfort with the mixing up of religion and politics, their despair over the kind of superstitions this country is immersed in, all of that is discounted, is not registered anywhere, in either in the public opinion, in the media. This is almost an invisible minority, but unfortunately a minority whose voice is crucial if India has to really fulfill its promises of becoming a secular democracy.
Nothing to kill or die.
Shocking news coming in of leading Kannada writer, scholar and former vice chancellor.
In the past 2 years, the rationalist minority was visible only in tragedy, when 3 prominent rationalist leaders were shot at and killed.
The 3 personalities, Dr. Dabolkar, Comrade Pansare and Kalburgi, they had in fact different political agendas. It is not that politically they were supporting one ideology. But the most important thing was they were opposed to superstitions. They were opposed to the interpretation of religion, which was anti-people and which was supporting the dominance of upper caste on Indian society.
Dr. Dabolkar jo manene upude talwal, Dr. Dabolkar jo manene upude.
Dabolkar's crusade was against superstition, and he was forcing government to pass the Anti-Superstition Act. And because of that only, certain sections in the society, especially the sadhus, boas and all these people, felt threatened. Pansare's was a crusade against religious obscurantism and communalism in Maharashtra. And as far as Dr. Kalburgi was concerned, Kalburgi was opposed to certain practices in the Virshaiva religion in Karnataka, and he was giving new interpretation of teachings of Mahatma Basaveshwar's philosophy. So that teaching was not acceptable to some of the obscurantist sections in Karnataka. Age is not important, ideas are important, and ideas create problems as far as these communal forces are concerned.
Well, what is scary about ideas are always found to be dangerous by some people who either don't have ideas or hate ideas for whatever reasons. So they find ideas dangerous. And if anybody holds such ideas, he is unacceptable to them. And what do? I mean, because if you had an idea, counter idea, you will bring forth the counter idea and enter into a dialogue or an argument. But if you don't have any such ideas, then what you do? You will abolish the idea itself, or at least the person who holds those ideas. So that's what happened.
For me, rationalism means tolerance. It means that in our society, lots of people with lots of opinions have equal right to live in this society.
मुझे लगता है यही सही एक rationalist atmosphere होता है कि सबकी बात सबको कहने की एक मुभा होनी चाहिए और इसके बाद कोई भी नई सोच accept करने की भी मुभा होनी चाहिए. हर एक को ये देख सोचने की का फ्रीडम है कि मैं मुझे क्या सही लगता है और यही रीज़न है ऐसा मुझे लगता है. तो इससे इनटॉलरेंस और टॉलरेंस का कंसेप्ट जो है वो रैशनलिज्म से बहुत जुड़ा है, क्योंकि हम लोग अगर इनटॉलरेंट होते हैं तो रैशनलिज्म ख़त्म हो जाता है.
दिस इज़ व्हाट साइंटिफिक टेंपर इज, टू एग्जामिन, टू एक्सेप्ट नथिंग जस्ट बिकॉज ट्रेडिशन, इट हैज़ बीन ट्रेडिशनल और ट्रेडिशनल अथॉरिटी सपोर्टेड. यू वॉन्ट टू हैव इंडिपेंडेंट rigorously collected evidence. You know, you have to challenge the beliefs that are handed down to you. I would say that for this non-believing minority, scientific temper is what they believe in.
An atheist may be irrational in other aspects. Somebody may say, I don't believe in God, but the caste system is perfectly all right. Somebody may say, I don't believe in God, but woman is weaker to man, without a shred of experimental evidence, because that is also a conclusion. But a rationalist goes a step further. And a rationalist says, I shall apply the methodology of science to anything before I come to a conclusion.
Transition from a very religious Christian to a atheist to a rationalist to a free thinker to a secular humanist was a long one, which started at the age of 13, and it's been a long journey. I was a very, very fanatically religious Christian till the age of 13, who went to church, prayed a couple of times a day, etc. What triggered the questioning phase was my sexuality. Everybody used to have boyfriends, and here I was having a girlfriend, and I wanted to know what Bible says. For me, everything went back to Bible. Everything I did, it was always Bible had to tell me it is the right thing to do. So I went to the Bible. I saw many verses in the Bible which says homosexuality is a sin, and I'm not normal, and I'm a sinner. And even the priest said I'm not a normal person. So that is what triggered it all.
The earliest connection I can see is when I was about 10 years old, when I went to some samadhi or some place which was supposed to be pakka, as they call it, and if you go there and do certain activity, you will not be able to walk 3 steps away from it and you will fall and die. And to demonstrate to my classmates when I was in class 6th, I went with them and I did exactly what one was not supposed to do, and nothing happened to me.
Before every examination, I had to pray to this God to make me perform well in the exam, and I was the topper in my class in school. By the time I was maybe around 10 years, I thought I'll conduct an experiment. Once before answering the examinations, I did not pray to God. I just made an attempt of standing and praying to God. But I did as well in the examination. I used to do it. Then I thought maybe God has nothing to do with the exam. So I thought I'd try another experiment. And the next exams came, I said, oh God, fail me in this exam. Pray to God. And I found that I did as well in the examination of the previous one. So I came to a decision, probably this actually does not exist.
I remember when in 9th grade there was a discussion about atheism, and when our teacher asked if any one of us is an atheist, I did not raise my hand at that time. I did not recognize atheism as my positive identity at that time. But then she started giving reasons for existence of God, and I saw people nodding to those reasons. But when pushed, when I talked to people about those reasons, no one really, you know, stood their ground. I mean, no one really believed in their own beliefs.
हमारा मैसेज होता है कि लोगों की सोच थोड़ी साइंटिफिक बने. जैसे कुछ हमने मैसेज देना है, एक झोली है हमारे पास, हम कैसे मैसेज देते हैं, ये खाली है. अब हम कहते हैं कि हमारे देश में इतनी एजुकेशन आ गई है, साइंटिस्ट बन रहे हैं, डॉक्टर बन रहे हैं, अंधविश्वास काम क्यों नहीं हो रहे, इसके लिए रीजन क्या है. हम एक मैसेज देने के लिए कहते हैं, भैया इसके लिए रीजन है हमारी पॉलिटिक्स, हमारा धर्म और आप लोग. फॉर एग्जांपल, ये धर्म वाले लोग हैं, ये हमारे गाँव में, हमारे शहरों में फैले हुए हैं, ये नहीं चाहते कि लोगों को अकल आ जाए, ये उलझा के रखना चाहते हैं, भैया 84 लाख यूनियन होती हैं, आप कुछ ऐसा नहीं करोगे तो आप भगवान आपको सजा देगा. ये लोगों को डरा के रखते हैं, ईमानदारी से धर्म का प्रचार नहीं कर रहे, ये चाहते हैं लोगों का दिमाग साइंटिफिक ना हो, इनको अकल ना आए. ये हमारे समाज में फैले हुए लोग हैं. दूसरी बात, अब रही ये पॉलिटिशियन को पता है कि हम गलत कर रहे हैं, लेकिन ये पॉलिटिशियन हमारे गांव के भी हो सकते हैं, हमारे शहर के भी हो सकते हैं, हमारे मिनिस्टर भी हो सकते हैं, इनको पता है साइंस का, लेकिन ये उलझा के रखना चाहते हैं धर्म के चक्कर में, ताकि लोग धार्मिक स्थान पे जाएं, ये किसी बाबा के साथ गांठ तो कर लें और उनको वोट बैंक के ऊपर कब्जा करने का मौका मिल जाए. कोई नामदान दे रहा है, कोई 500 पदक दे रहा है, कोई कहीं बैठा है, कोई कहीं बैठा है, कभी ये मंदिर में जाते हैं, कभी मस्जिद में जाते हैं, कभी गुरुद्वारे में जाते हैं. ये चाहते हैं कि जो वोट बैंक का जो लोग हैं बेवकूफ़ बने रहें, हमें इनकी पहचान करनी होगी, क्योंकि गाँव में भी हैं, शहर में भी हैं. अब रही आम पब्लिक, ये भी दोषी है अंधविश्वास के लिए. क्योंकि आम पब्लिक के दिमाग में ठूस के भर दिया गया है कि भैया अगर आप बुरा नहीं किसी को अच्छा नहीं बोल सकते, बुरा भी मत कहो। अब हम कहते हैं बुरा क्यों नहीं कहोगे, बुरे को तो बुरे कहने की हिम्मत रखो। अब चोर है, डाकू है, अब उनको बुरा कब कहोगे अगर आप इस बात से निकलोगे तभी। अब हम कहते हैं हमारे पंजाब में चलता शरबत का भला, मैं सभी लोगों का भला मांगो। भैया कैसे, कोई बलात्कारी है, कोई डाकू है, कोई चोर है, आप उसका भी भला मांग रहे हो भगवान से? आपकी तो दिमाग ही बंद हो गया कि आपने उनसे बदला लेना है, आप उनके खिलाफ कार्रवाई करो। हम ये कहते हैं भैया आप तीन लोग, धर्म वाले लोग, राजनीतिक लोग और आप आम लोग बराबर के रिस्पॉन्सिबल हैं इन ड्रामेबाजियों के लिए, इस अंधविश्वास के लिए। ये वैसे जोली खाली है तो हमने एक ट्रिक का सहारा लिया है। हम कहते हैं कि भैया हर 5 साल के बाद ये इलेक्शन में आपसे वोट मांगने आ जाते हैं, ये धर्म वाले, राजनीतिक और आप सभी का गठजोड़ जो है ये अंधविश्वास फैलाने में आगे है। ये देखने में तो अलग अलग लगते थे लेकिन निकले इकट्ठे हैं और आपस में एक यूनिटी है। जब तक ये यूनिटी नहीं टूटेगी, इनकी सोच साइंटिफिक नहीं होगी, पब्लिक की, राजनीतिक लोग ईमानदार नहीं होंगे, धार्मिक लोग ईमानदार नहीं होंगे, हमारे देश में ऐसे ही चलता रहेगा। कभी मंदिर तोड़ देंगे ये, कभी मंदिर बनाने के चक्कर में आ जाएंगे, कभी कोई गुरुद्वारा तोड़ देंगे, ये आपस में लड़ाते रहेंगे और वोट बैंक अपना पक्का करते रहेंगे।
Nationalists take it upon themselves to inculcate scientific temper in the larger population, they provoke the powers of convention and religion.
कोल्हापुर में तो हमें ये दिखाई दिया कि कभी भी पहले हिंदू मुस्लिम राइट नहीं हुई, दंगल नहीं हुई, लेकिन कुछ महीने पहले क्या हुआ था कि एक मैसेज वायरल हो गया था और जिसमें शिवाजी महाराज की किसी ने बदनामी की थी, तो उसको लेके मिडनाइट में हिंदुत्ववादी फोर्सेस उसमें थे और उन्होंने कुछ मुस्लिम लोगों को टारगेट करके उनकी दुकानें लूटी, उनका बहुत नुकसान पहुंचाया। तो रात को तो किसी को पता ही नहीं चला कि ये पूरा प्लान्ड था ये सब, और सुबह में जब हम लोगों को पता चला कि इस तरह की घटना हुई है, तो कॉमरेड पानसरे ने एक बहुत लीड लेके, इनिशिएटिव लेके कोल्हापुर के सभी ये जो शांततावादी तत्व है उन सब लोगों को इकट्ठा किया, सब संगठनों को इकट्ठा किया और उन्होंने खुद लोगों से जाके मदद इकट्ठा की। तो इस तरह के इंसिडेंसेस होते रहे बहुत दिन से, ब्लैंक कॉल्स आते थे, तो हमने वो घर में भी महसूस किया है कि एक टाइप का टेंशन था घर में। लेकिन हमेशा से कॉमरेड पानसरे ये कहते आ रहे थे कि मैं अहिंसा से काम कर रहा हूँ, मैं अपना विचार, अपनी सोच लोगों के सामने रख रहा हूँ, इस देश के कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन ने मुझे फ्रीडम ऑफ एक्सप्रेशन का हक दिया है और इस हक से मैं मेरी अपनी मन की बात कहीं भी कह सकता हूँ।
आज तमाम ऐसी ताकतें हैं जो ये कह रही हैं कि सत्य का सिर्फ एक रूप होता है, मजहब का सिर्फ एक रूप होता है, पूजा पाठ, धर्म कांड, रीति रिवाज जो जैसी है वो वैसी ही रहेंगी और उसको कोई चुनौती भी नहीं दे सकता है, उस पर कोई बात भी नहीं कर सकता है।
The all pervasive concern is with safeguarding the constitutional rights of each and every citizen to live as she chooses. This we see is being violated every day, with old divisions such as caste becoming deeper and more violent, with new divisions being created to shrink the space for discussion and debate, with educational, cultural and other institutions being weakened further by censorship and fear of debate. And worst of all, the idea of India the idea our freedom fighters envision being distorted into a homogenous India with its diversity torn apart.
Even secularism, according to worldwide definition, is based on rationalism. Welfare in this world, and not on the basis of afterlife or what religion sanctions. So secularism is also rational. So they are both very closely related, and that is why BJP and RSS and others and their like-minded parties are hostile to rationalism.
Interestingly, Indian rationalists make religious forces insecure, even though their movement is considered a relative failure in comparison to the West.
One has to, I think, go back to at least, 19th century when modernity in India, in the sense, takes off, the modern project takes off. That is when science and technology are kind of implanted in India. But I think even amongst the best Indian scientific minds, scientific rationalism clashed with their deep sense of nationalism.
So far as we are concerned, we are definitely committed to encouraging science and technology, encouraging it not only in its various technical fields, but to build up the scientific temper, a scientific approach to life's problems.
When modern science comes to India, modern institutions of education and research begin to take off, Indians participate in it, but at the same time, remain deeply committed to the Indian nationalistic project. That, I think, prevented what the kind of enlightenment, the kind of cultural revolutions that took place in 18th century Europe, 18th, 19th century Europe, where scientific ideas were not just used to improve your economic standard or to, lead to industry or some innovations and inventions, but also to question, to put the inherited religions under a critical scientific examination. For instance, coming of Darwinism, deeply conflicted with the biblical creation story. The cultural ferment that took place in Europe, and in fact in parts of Asia as well, in Japan and China, due to different circumstances, just did not happen in India. Science was co-opted into religion itself. We started using the scientific vocabulary to defend totally unscientific ideas like astrology, like even some ideas of yoga, some ideas of Ayurveda. We started justifying these ancient sciences, which actually have been falsified by the advances in modern science.
Science has been establishment activity in India. Science has not been people's activity. Science has not been an activity which has been talking about social change and so on and so forth. It is like this, I'm a scientist, I will create maybe some missile and then I will help the state. But is creation of a missile a scientific activity at all? One needs to think about that. So equipping the whole country and the psyche of people with the scientific thought and scientific temperament has not been the agenda of this state. And since science has been primarily state-sponsored, it has not been the agenda of scientists either.
In a society which is so divided and distributed among so many castes and clans and faiths and what you have, the rationalists have to move carefully and see that they do not antagonize people by insisting on aspects which are perhaps beyond rationality. So they must recognize that there are limits to rationality, that rationality itself cannot become a religion. I mean, just as religions can't be expected to be rational all the time, you can't expect rationality to take over religion. That was the mistake which was committed by communism, by making the ideology a religion. And therefore, it failed ultimately.
There is new challenge to, one can say, individualism, liberalism and secularism as far as Western political philosophy is concerned. For almost 100 years, there was a dominance of liberalism, the liberalism which believed in autonomy of individual, liberalism which believed in individual freedom, liberalism which believed in social reforms and all these things. But now there is a threat to liberalism from new ideologies, and these ideologies come from communitarian ideology and the multiculturalist ideology. All over the world, as far as these concepts are concerned, individual freedom or autonomy of individual, they are being threatened, because individual self or individual's ideology is essentially rooted in his social context. His self is being, one can say, influenced by the cultural traditions, the cultural taboos, social practices of the society in which they live in. And because of that, they say that all over the world, now there is a revolt against this type of individualism. And everywhere people are asserting their religious, ethnic and cultural, one can say, identities. So therefore now communitarians are saying that liberalism has to revise their concept of individual freedom, and due care has to be taken as far as susceptibilities of religious groups, their own cultural practices and cultural ideologies. Now rationalists and the liberals have to face this new threat.
Since we are not a religion, we have no fixed laws, and we cannot smite people, we cannot, you know, banish people. So there's a lot of conflict. And since everyone is a, you know, free thinker, they think for themselves, you cannot dictate any rules. You have to rationalize rules. And of course, there's conflict of interest, there's conflict of ideologies between people of different generations, between people of different genders, between people of different backgrounds. So it's I believe the most challenging part is having them work together for things they stand for together.